just click diligence. Perfect. Awesome. I'm just going to time myself so I have a good idea. Well, thank you everyone for being here. There are no participatory exercises during my talk, unfortunately. Disclosure. So sorry to burst that bubble. But thank you all so much for being here. It's been wonderful to see so many colleagues and so many of my own patients and all of you gathered here on this like amazing Boston weather day that we're having to come connect about Lynch syndrome. My name's Vinod Nambudiri and I am thrilled to be here. So I have 10 minutes and pop quiz, what's the largest organ in your body? Great. So you learned something I didn't have to teach you already. So what I'm trying to say is hopefully this talk will kind of get your ears perked up because everybody's got some skin in the game, if you will. And so we'll hopefully get you some insights that you can walk out of here with today. Three things that I want to touch on. So as a dermatologist, when I'm working at the Farber or at the Brigham, where I see patients on both campuses, you know, I think a lot about what are the skin manifestations of Lynch syndrome. So I wouldn't be a good dermatologist if I didn't show you some pictures of skin things here today. So that'll be actually the bulk of what I want to talk about, because I think I can enlist all of you in participating in the skin cancer screening process related to Lynch syndrome. We'll talk a little bit about what that involves. And for those of you who have met me or another dermatologist, you've probably been through a full body skin exam before, but just to review what that looks like and what it means for you as a patient or as a family member of someone with Lynch syndrome, however you're connected here today. And then lastly, some skin protection principles that regardless of if you have Lynch syndrome or not, will hopefully be able to help you on your like skin health journey. So let's talk a little bit about some skin manifestations of Lynch syndrome. When we think about this, there are many different kinds of skin growths that can be prevalent in individuals with Lynch syndrome. And I want to emphasize that they can both be either cancerous or non-cancerous. So skin cancers are very common, but non-cancerous skin growths are also very common and perhaps way more common. So something to think about, something to look at. You know, my colleagues who are like gastroenterologists will also tell you the same is true about things in your colon. There are things that can develop that are cancerous, there are things that can develop that are non-cancerous, right? The skin, we just have the added challenge or benefit that everyone can see it themselves. So, you know, there's a lot that people can get concerned about, even though it may not be cancerous at all. These things can develop in folks with who have Lynch syndrome, either in the context of having an internal organ cancer or not. It can be independent. And so that's important to keep in mind. There can be some folks who can only have skin-related things that are found and no other cancer-related diagnoses. And if you have a skin-related growth or lesion or skin cancer, it can develop either before or after the development of internal organ cancer. So something to keep in mind. Changing or growing skin lesions are things that you should always be mentioning to your physician. And even if it's not your dermatologist, if it's any physician that you're coming in to see, you follow with an oncologist, you follow with a gastroenterologist, you follow with a primary care physician, you follow with anyone that you're plugged into that you're seeing, mention it because that's something that anyone can at least take an initial look at and help get you the right assessment or help get you plugged into the care that you need. So sort of like when you go to the airport and they say, if you see something, say something, this is your opportunity, right? So if you see something on your skin, say something to, you know, maybe not the TSA person, but tell your doctor. So when we talk about skin findings in Lynch syndrome, one of the things I want to clue you in on is this word or this phrase or this thing that keeps coming up, which is this concept of a sebaceous gland. So glands are any part of our body that produce or secrete something. We all have sweat glands. They're all firing right now because you just did this like exercise situation. But we also have these things called sebaceous glands. Sebaceous glands are not sweat glands, but they produce oil of the skin. And so they actually kind of keep your skin sort of moisturized. You all got to know and love your sebaceous glands when you went through puberty because they were the things that gave you acne. They were like those oil-filled spots that kind of developed, and everyone has a hormonal surge when they go through puberty. And so that's when they actually particularly get activated. And that's why you don't see like acne in very young children. Sebum is that oily substance they secrete. And this, you know, cartoon here shows that sebaceous glands are attached to hair follicles. So every place like on your body, basically, where you can see a hair gland, a hair shaft, there's likely a small, teeny tiny sebaceous gland or more than one associated with it. they do play an important function, but sometimes they sort of go overboard, and that's what I'd like to include here. There are some patient pictures. None of them are my patients. These are all things that are out there in the literature, the medical literature, but I thought it was important to include some of these so that people can know what to look for. And I also think it's important to know that all of these things happen in any skin tone or skin color or skin type. So you are not alone, no matter who you are, that these are things that we see across the board in all patient populations. So there's a fancy term that you may hear, like your dermatologist or other doctors throw out, that's called sebaceous hyperplasia. Hyperplasia basically just means enlargement. So these are totally normal glands. They're either just bigger than normal, or you have more of them than you possibly should, or that we normally see on average. This is totally fine. It's totally benign. It's very common whether or not an individual has Lynch syndrome, and it may be more common in people with Lynch syndrome because of what we'll talk about, just kind of this increased propensity to have sebaceous things that show up. They are often totally painless, asymptomatic. You only notice them because they tend to be concentrated like on the face. And every morning, if you look in the mirror, you're brushing your teeth, you're like, oh, I noticed this spot. What is it? Most likely or more commonly than not, it's something that's totally benign and sebaceous hyperplasia. Typically don't do anything to treat them. It's sort of leave and let be. Sebaceous adenomas are a variant of sebaceous gland growths, and these are often slightly larger than your sebaceous hyperplasia. You can see here on this gentleman's cheek, there's sort of like a larger bump there. These are still benign growths, but they can mimic skin cancer, and so it's important that whoever's seeing you, your dermatologist or your physician from another specialty, if you see something that's growing on your face, you do want to bring that up, and they may consider doing a biopsy, which is a sample of the skin. And what that does is it allows us to get one of those images that I showed on the previous slide, that kind of purple bluish pathology image, to make a definitive diagnosis under the microscope. The good news is if it comes back as a sebaceous adenoma, again, it's 100% benign. It's not anything dangerous for you, but it may actually be a marker that you yourself are someone who carries a propensity for Lynch syndrome, because these are much more common. Sebaceous carcinoma, this is a sort of zoomed in view of a spot that's on a patient's eyelid. You can tell those are like eyelashes, that's the eyeball in and of itself. So this is like right on the upper eyelid margin. And this is a true form of skin cancer. I picked this photo in particular because the most, one of the most common areas is in this kind of like sunglass distribution. So the area of your face that is covered by your sunglasses is what we call periocular. So that's your eyelids, the upper cheek, kind of bottom of the forehead. Those areas are where you will commonly see sebaceous carcinomas. So if you notice something growing in that area, you want to bring that particularly up to the attention of your physician. I often tell my patients to look for something that maybe starts like a pimple, but it doesn't go away. So we all have had pimples. We know what they are. They're annoying, but the news is they don't last forever. So if you have something that's like a pimple and it's still there more than a month or two later, let someone know about it. It still could be 100% benign. There are many other things that can do that. But if something's not going away, we want to know about it. So that's sort of what you want to be on the lookout for. This is another example of another sebaceous carcinoma. It's a little bit lower than that sunglass distribution, but it's still kind of like mid-cheek area. Kind of looks like something that could have been a pimple or, you know, like sort of a mild blemish. But if it's not going away for several months or so, bring that to someone's attention. I do like to try to incorporate some of the scientific, you know, literature, the medical literature into my talks for patients as well, because I think it's important to keep you all informed. There are clinical guidelines about the management of sebaceous carcinoma. And the reason that I put this in here is to know that the primary goal of treatment is basically to remove it. So unlike many, many, many other cancers that you may hear from today or yesterday or over the course of the management of various cancers, for almost all skin cancers, when they're caught early, the management is cut it out, done. So all the more reason to be proactive with the screening. These are not things that are typically managed with chemotherapy or radiation or other modalities. It's really you see someone, then you see someone like me, and we like take care of it. So in the grand scheme of things, it's to your advantage to catch stuff early, and so get people involved. There are a couple other skin cancers that I want to talk about. One is called a keratoacanthoma. It's a variant of a skin cancer called squamous cell, which is very, very common. This particular variant of squamous cell is more common in patients with Lynch syndrome than others. So I bring that up as a type. It often has this like very rapid growth. People sometimes think it's a boil or a cyst, and it grows very quickly in the matter of like a couple weeks. But the good news is it's also usually very, very treatable, and you just remove it and done. So if you see something like this, it often has that striking appearance and it comes on very quickly. But the good news is it doesn't tend to spread anywhere else. We see it, we remove it, you're done. I want to say a word finally about non-Lynch syndrome specific skin findings or skin cancers, and those are things that you may have heard about just in general. So the three most common skin cancer types are what we call basal cell, which is the top two photos. They often have either a pinkish or purplish appearance, squamous cell, which can be a little bit more of a red, raised, or even scaly bump, and then something called melanoma, which is the cancer that comes from pigmented cells that usually has like a brownish appearance. As a just matter of fact out there, skin cancers are the most common cancers that are diagnosed in the human population. Every year alone in the United States, there are more than 5 million skin cancers diagnosed in among 3 million people. And so these are super, 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 super common, even in the general population. And so it's something to look out for, to know, and we'll talk about how you can prevent it. I want to acknowledge so many people in the room here today who are part of the Lynch Syndrome Center, who have been helpful in helping us advance knowledge related to skin cancers and Lynch syndrome. I won't go into the details of our research too extensively because it's sort of out of the scope of what we're talking about, but we're really interested in looking at clinical factors associated with the development of skin cancers in patients with Lynch syndrome here at the Dana-Farber. And so our work continues onward. The lead author on this paper, Dr. Zong, is actually joining us as faculty come this summer, and we're super excited to work with her and continue our ongoing collaborations in this space. The last two slides that I want to talk about are what you can do for skin cancer screening and prevention. There's a ton of really great resources that are out there on skin cancer screening for our patients with Lynch syndrome, and the Lynch Syndrome Center here does an amazing job about this. We try to get everyone plugged in for at least an annual exam with a dermatologist. If you do have high risk features, we sometimes will consider even more often, like you've had a number of skin cancers, we might see you more often, like every 6 months, to make sure we stay ahead of things. But at least as a baseline, everyone gets plugged in for an annual screening exam. And I do recommend patients, like I said, if you see something new growing or changing, you know, keep an eye out, check your skin, check yourself every month or two, just make sure there's nothing new or different. And then there's this handy dandy mnemonic that are the ABCDEs of skin cancer. If you see spots that are asymmetric, have irregular borders, they have strange or multiple colors within them, the diameter is large, or I really want to harp on this, if they are evolving or changing, those are the spots that you want to bring to the attention of your doctor. And then lastly, skin protection principles. So there's all sorts of great things that you can do, like staying inside forever, but that's kind of impractical. So when we talk to our patients, I never tell them they can't leave their house, but I tell them, you know, you want to be smart about what you're doing. So SPF, or sun protection factor 30 or higher sunscreen, is what you want to use to be most effective. That blocks 97% of UV rays. Why do we care so much about UV rays? UV rays induce DNA damage. And as you've heard here, or probably heard before, Lynch syndrome, there's a DNA damage repair deficiency, right? So if we think about that, we don't want you to get exposed to things that can damage your DNA, right? And so UV does it. Tanning beds are basically like cancer beds, so don't go in them. And those are things that you want to avoid. If you want to daily use a gentle cleanser or a gentle soap on your skin that gets rid of debris that you don't need hanging out there, and then daily moisturization is good to promote sort of intact skin health and prevent breakdown of the skin barrier. Avoiding peak hours of sun exposure, which is 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. for outdoor exposure, and then smoking is also something that we know ages the skin aggressively. So I think with that, those are the things that I'd like to say. I'd be happy to take questions during our panel, happy to have people reach out to me, and then look forward to continuing to work with you all and connect with you all in the future. Thanks.